my hero. He was the best.
Indomitable.
Or he was my hero.
It's the best boss ever.
Courageous.
Mike just knew how to live life.
He was the most genuine guy you could ever meet.
I met Mike in 94.
I met Michael 1998. It was summer of 98. I started working at Top Cow.
I met Mike in sort of an unusual way at a poker game.
Mike and I had an extremely close relationship, more than mom and son.
I'd say 15, 20 artists working on site at all hours. It was 24 hours a day, and there was Mike just kind of standing there in the studio, like, hey, introduce himself.
We went into Mike's office, and Mike had like the coolest office in Top Cow. He had like his couch and the TV setups and everything, and they were playing video games.
I knew the president of the company, Brad Foxhoven of Top Cow, because I shopped at his brother's comic book store.
We were both at the same convention. I was both the 94 San Diego Comic Con.
He would just give you critiques or opinions and suggestions, and funny thing, like, his suggestions were always awesome.
And I was terrible at cards, and he was very good.
He could tell me anything, and literally more than I ever wanted to know sometimes.
Anyone who's ever met Mike, they know instantly that he's just that guy who's likable.
And Mike, of course, was way better than me and killed me probably 26 times before I did anything.
I went with Brad and Michael to lunch that day at San Diego Con, and that was the first time I ever met Mike.
Mike grew up in Crossville, Tennessee. We lived on a big lake, and our home was on a peninsula in the middle of that lake, and we had a small boathouse and kept a boat underneath there. And Mike was a little bit afraid of the water at 2 years old, but then he kept it up. He kept skiing, his brother kept skiing, and they competed with each other all the time. So they just got exponentially better by having each other to compete with. So he began taking barefoot water ski lessons and just got better and better. They kept entering all the competitions, and at 12, Mike became national barefoot water ski champion.
Anything he tried, he usually excelled at. And from that point on, it was, here he is trying it, here he is excelling at it, here he is being the best at it.
And he was different than everybody else because he sort of was, he had this air about him that was not us. I mean, we were all the, Mike was out and he was successful. He did water skiing. He was like, you know, that cool kid in high school.
From the time he was two, he was always wanting a piece of paper and a pencil. And he just drew and drew and drew.
When he was younger, he used to draw all the time. He drew his mom and his brother and everybody as superheroes and whatnot. And he, in high school, used to tell me he'd be the one that would always get tagged to draw the homecoming banners or different artwork that they needed for a school or whatnot.
He didn't read comic books. He never had art lessons in high school or anything, so he definitely was able to develop his own personal style.
He never was into comic books, really, because this is a story Mike used to tell all the time. His town where he grew up was a smaller town in Tennessee, and they didn't have too many comic book shops and everything. And
what do you mean you never draw superheroes as a kid? Look at this crappy Batman from when you were seven. He's like, oh, well, and I'm like, yeah, right, whatever.
He played video games, you know, when Dungeon Master and all those things came out, and Avatar or something, so I don't know all of it.
You know, it was Batman from the TV, or it was Batman from some other place. And you're a little kid, you pick up these things all over the place.
A video game, anything in life, anything he did, if he hadn't tried it before, it just took a couple times of doing it, and he became good at it, and then he became great at it, And it was like that with pretty much everything for him growing up.
He had great admiration and love for his stepfather, Jim Crick.
Med school, he was a doctor, or training to become a doctor.
And he would tell them funny stories about the emergency room and all this, and they just absolutely adored him. So he kept talking to Jim, and he wanted to be like him.
It was not his thing. Not that he wasn't succeeding at it. He was doing really well.
So he came to us and said that he wanted to drop out of school and go experience life more on the West Coast, or to start out in Aspen.
He did. He left town. He worked his way across the country and did various stuff. And when he got to Aspen, this is a whole another world for him.
He had truly never been too many times out of Tennessee, and when he got to Aspen, he loved it so much.
His personality really developed there, I think, where he found that in being himself, he was more like the people there than he was like the people in Tennessee. And so he just continued to develop his personality that way, and then decided that later he would move to the West Coast.
The reason he got into comics was because he was in Choi Lee Foot karate, and he was an instructor, and he wound up getting hurt. He broke his foot, and so while he was laid up, he wound up doing some submissions because his mom was telling him she was good friends with Shell Dorf.
Shell Dorf was one of the original founders of the San Diego Comic-Con.
So after he broke his foot, that was just the time that he, you know, he started spending. He wasn't at school, and he wasn't, you know, sitting around on the couch.
And he said, the comic convention is coming up, so have Mike give me a call.
His mom had encouraged him to do samples for Shell Dorf, who was running the convention.
So I called Mike, and I said, okay, get up. First thing you're going to do in the morning is call Shell Dorf. This call is going to change the rest of your life.
Mike put together, I think it was 6 pages of submissions at the time, and went and showed them around, and wound up getting 3 different phone calls, and David Wall from Top Cow was one of them.
David Wall, who was our editor-in-chief at the time, was looking around at samples, and he found this guy named Michael Turner, who I had never heard of. I actually had not met him at the convention. He found him actually at the San Diego show.
He did backgrounds, of course, first, and then he would listen very carefully to all the critique.
Draw me a building. Yeah, draw me a building. Go over there, I gave him a piece of paper, put him in the corner, you know, far from everyone else. I said, draw me a building, you know, just to see, because I had no idea. I hadn't seen the samples. I had no idea of his skill level.
And then he would go to the bookstore and buy every drawing book that ever was and just flip through them all very, very quickly. And he absorbed the information like a sponge. And
a little while later, he comes back. And the thing about Mike is that he was never afraid. You know, he was never intimidated, never afraid. He just came back and just showed me his page. You know, there was no shaking, nothing. You know, just like, what do you think? It's awful. It's awful. And I still remember to this day, and I still remember thinking in my head that this was not a building. This was a loaf of bread standing vertically.
He did some really bad pinups and some really bad backgrounds for Marc.
And all I did was I reached over to a shelf of reference that we had nearby, photo books of city, anything that we had. There was one of New York, and I just pulled it out of the shelf, and I randomly looked through the book, and I found a page of a building that I thought was interesting. Very detailed, very, one of the old school New York buildings. And I said, okay, Mike, draw this, and draw me this building. Okay, he went away for like an hour, 2 hours. Went back to my thing, doing my stuff, and you know, he comes back and said, well, okay, here it is. You know, shows me the paper. Again, he's not shaking anything. Even after the beatdown he got, not shaking. I just looked at it. I took it from him. I was just looking at it. I was looking at him. I was looking at the paper. I'm going, in my head, I didn't tell him this because you just don't say that right off the bat, but I'm thinking, it's one of the best buildings I've ever seen anybody draw.
He didn't have the formalized art training. He would always draw. He was always artistic, but he never really had art, either art school or art background.
Yeah, he definitely started his backgrounds helping Marc, but soon he became so good so fast.
So once he started learning it, once he was sitting around all of us, he suddenly got a lot better, a lot faster.
Mike never realized his own talent. This was raw talent at its rawest. He didn't even know enough to look at a picture of a building to draw the building. And no one had ever told him to do that. And that's when I realized that there's something here. And the acceleration was phenomenal.
He was having fun, but he also understood that this was work, this was business, that he was making a career out of it.
I was just fascinated to see what he could do. All right, try this. Try this.
One of the most intense things was that the inker and penciler page division. The way it generally works in comics is once the pages are printed, you have the pages are then returned to the artist as a courtesy so they can then sell them.
Yeah, and every time something was thrown at him, not only did it come back better than we expected, it came back at a whole new level, especially considering how fast. Quickly, we gave him trading cards. Back then in the industry, trading cards were a very big business.
Everybody else would do this in about half an hour, 20 minutes. They'd take the breakdown of a book. I want this page. And they're like, you can have that one, you can have this one. And it's over. These guys would be there till midnight. I mean, these would be 5-6 hour ordeals as they negotiated it.
And I think it was halfway through the collection of cards that we were working on, we went, this guy is just, he's getting just too damn good. He can't do cards anymore. Let's come up with something for him to do in a comic book.
And so they gave him the Ballistic miniseries. That came out before Witchblade. It was Ballistic 1-2-3 that Michael did.
Which was a spinoff of Cyberforce, a character, a female character. It was already within the trading cards. You could tell that Mike had a knack for something. And it was the female form.
Mike went from Ballistic to Strikeforce. Little small pieces here and there, and then from that he moved into Witchblade.
We pulled him into it, and we said, "This is the right guy for the right project at the right time," and it proved completely 100% true.
Witchblade at the time, there was nothing coming out that looked like that. Just from the overall aesthetics of the art and the colors and the style and the feel when you read that book. That was one of the few books where you're like, oh, I can't wait till next month.
But we saw something in a concept which was basically Excalibur, the sword and the stone. But in our case, it was the gauntlet.
The thing is that it was a magic thing for a lot of fans. They've never seen anything like it before.
We'll take that mythology. We'll put it on a female lead because we've got a guy that we think could really help here and bring the female lead to the forefront and pull this whole concept together, and that was Mike.
And that was the first time that I'd ever seen anybody in comics draw women that looked like that.
Yeah, Witchblade was just huge for Mike and instantly catapulted him into stardom, and he just rolled with it better than anybody.
That was a great experience, loved it. Kind of getting his bearings as a creator, something from complete scratch. And he started talking about his love for scuba diving and his love of the ocean.
He was on a shark dive in Tahiti with his brother.
He was just fascinated that just below the surface of the sea was an entirely different world that seemed so unexplored to him.
And Mike and Jake wanted to follow the sharks that they were eating because they said it was just so powerful.
And one night when we were out drinking, a famous drinking night.
He had never experienced anything like that ever.
We had just started talking about this stuff, and he and I have a different path of coming to the same place and feeling about the water.
He had a library full of books about the sea.
He loved the water. You know, he was a champion skier, even barefoot skier, but that was Mike anyway.
It's just unbelievable how much is actually just right there underneath the surface, and that's what Mike wanted to explore.
He was fascinated with the world undersea, and he was also fascinated with the mythologies of some of the big sci-fi franchises like Star Wars and such like that.
And at the very time, you know, he was still just pitching the idea.
He developed a theory about there might be an underwater race of people.
And I wasn't really a part of formulating the plot, but immediately after doing this, I'm like, okay, we got to do this.
So when Mike was talking about Fathom and what this character would be, I was really excited for him. You know, and I helped out as much as I could, you know, just conversing, and he would just bounce off ideas, and it's like, oh, that's pretty cool. And it's like,
because obviously he knew, you know, like Submariner, Aquaman had been around for years and years and years, and they had, you know, Aquaman communicating with fish and things to that effect, but Mike didn't want any of that in his book.
So we just took it that level with him. And then Peter Steigerwald had come on eventually.
Began thinking, okay, and they probably had a really good looking heroine in this.
You know, everything we were talking about, I was like, that's awesome.
She was probably able to control water and all these things.
He wanted to put this fantastical spin on it with a sci-fi element, yet keep it grounded with Aspen being a part of all those worlds.
And it also became Book of the Year.
And I mean, the story, everybody instantaneously just loved it, and he just did an awesome job.
Fathom had been optioned to be a movie.
Yeah, I always bothered Mike about the movie, like, when's this going to come out? There was a script a long time ago, and he's like, you can read the script. He's like, it's not Fathom.
Mike had read a couple of scripts and was very upset by what they were trying to turn it into.
Her name was Aspen, sure, but pretty much every other element of the book was altered and adjusted and changed. And
I never fully read the script, but it was about just a teenager living on the beach and things like that. And he's like, we didn't make the movie because it wasn't Fathom. That wasn't the movie.
Aspen was talking to fish and all these different things that Mike didn't want.
And I honestly feel like this is the movie that Mike wanted, because it's his core idea. It's everything that he was looking to do.
So eventually we came back to Mike, all the rights, and moving forward, now we're in 2007, and I get a call, and I wound up meeting Megan Fox's old agent.
And I think really, like, this movie, like, he actually got to talk with Megan, he got to talk with the producers.
They're trying to be very loyal to Mike's spirit and what he had in mind, and I think a lot of that is driven by Megan Fox.
And they were really like, oh, it'd be great to do this and that, and like, and it's finally like in the direction that he wanted it to be.
Who Megan was turning 21 and wanted a gift, and Megan has always been a big fan of Michael's, and I'm not just saying that because I know a lot of people, you know, when they read online, they're like, oh, Megan's not a big fan of his stuff, and she's blah, blah, blah.
It was so funny because she really is a fan of his stuff.
Oh, she knew about the character and all that stuff.
When she came in, yeah, she already had all Mike's books. When she was in high school, she read Witchblade, she read Fathom.
I think the idea of making it with her becomes something that could very well be possible.
She definitely knew of Michael, knew of our company, knew of everything, and that's why her agent had called me, because he wanted to get a gift for her birthday of a drawing.
And it sucks that he can't see it on the screen, because he loved movies. He was always watching movies.
He and I had a very special relationship because of his cancer.
He had gone snowboarding and he took a big fall.
I still remember the last trip that we had before he was.
He thought he had bumped his hip, and his hip kept hurting him and hurting him. And So he talked to my ex-husband, who had been a doctor, and he said, you know, this just keeps hurting. I don't know what's going on.
So it was Frank, Kelly, Mike, John Livesay, and myself. They went out first, and I came out a couple days later.
When he said that he was sick, it completely threw me for a loop. I had no idea, that that's what he was going to say.
So I walked around, and I remember Frank and Mike and John were playing volleyball, just screwing around. The rest of the tourists were off doing something else. And Mike looks at me, and he's like, "Where the hell did you come from?"
Seriously, has the whole world just right there, just right there. Fathom had been sold as a movie, and the book was doing great, and we had this huge tour going on.
And I'm like, it's like, how'd you walk to the secret island? And I'm like, you're stupid.
That it surprised him too. I mean, young guy, you know, 28 years old, discovers by accident that he's got this cancerous growth on his hip.
But that was like the last time where we knew that he was healthy. It was awesome because he had this big grin on his face. He was slightly tanned. He was just having a good time. And I was like, how's your hip? And he's like, man, it's still bugging me, but I don't care. I'm in Hawaii. I'm having a good time.
About 3 or 4 years later, my son, who was then 14, got the same cancer. It's very rare. It's
what? And anyone who knew Mike Turner at that time was like, no, you don't. Guys like you don't get cancer.
Mike was an inspiration to my son. Mike, like my son, never gave up hope and never complained, never wondered why this had happened to them.
You love your life too much, you know, and you live it too much. You know, you don't get cancer. You know, this is what I was thinking. You know, I didn't say that.
And so they shared a very special bond, and because of that, I shared that with Mike as well.
The doctors told him that he might not be able to walk again.
They took out just about 8 pounds of bone from his body on the first surgery. And it was just so weird because, you know, I didn't know if he was going to be able to ever walk again or ever do anything again. And there was hundreds of questions. And
they already showed me the scar. And it's like, I was looking at him going, dude, you just went through all this and you just had all this done to you. And you're one of the most physical guys I've ever met. And he's going, wow, dude, check out this scar. Look at what they did. It's like, oh, great. It's like.
Well, as it turned out, after recovering from this surgery and, again, smiling through everything.
Why aren't you devastated? You know, that's what I was thinking in my head. You know?
It just didn't worry him as much anymore because he knew there was much more to life than getting upset or worrying about certain things.
He walked again. He danced. He even jogged a little bit. He scuba dived, bungee jumped. He did just a little bit of everything, and the doctors thought he was just amazing.
He lived life to its fullest every single day.
He was saying, but it's going to be fine. I'm going to fight it. Yeah, I'm going to fight it. And you knew that he would. Yeah, you knew that he would fight it.
And so even though he had a really long break, when he came back, people were obviously ecstatic. And that's when Fathom 12 with the tour was going on. And we started, you know, getting everything hyped again and started hyping the next big story arc because everything was ending. And
there wasn't any choice for him that cancer was not something that was going to get him down.
You know, he was always, for the duration of when he had the cancer, he was always really awesome at being able to deal with it, and he never let on how, you know, much pain he was in.
But he told me some things, like, he's like, yeah, like, it was a horrible thing, and he's like, I beat it, and I'm ready to get back to life or whatever. Like, he was already starting to change gears towards the positive.
That was also a time in his life where he had just conquered this awful, horrible thing, and it really meant that he was like, I don't care about sitting down at the drawing table, I want to do stuff.
realized life was short, and he wanted to develop the characters and the storylines that he wanted to do, and he felt like he could expand himself and his art greatly by doing that. And so he did leave Top Cow and start his own company and called it Aspen.
It was really, I mean, it was pretty much the valley opposed to the peaks of the 90s. And so it wasn't a great time to start a company, you know, and it wasn't a time when you would expect a company to survive.
He hired some very talented people to work with him.
By the time the end of 2002 came around, I was at the same place where Mike was mentally. Mike wanted to expand out and do his own job. And
so what these guys really did was just amazing to me, that they were able to not only just overcome the challenges of his lawsuit and starting a new company from scratch, but not only that, but doing it in a landscape where people weren't buying comics at the time.
Bottom line is, Mike just knew it was time for a change.
Aspen started out originally in my apartment.
And again, it goes back to the tribute of how Mike ran, you know, his life and how he did everything. You know, there was no let's fail, let's quit, let's, you know, let's jump off the boat right now because we're not going to make it in the harbor. No,
we just took a little bit of time off, figured out a few things where we wanted to be, checked out a few office spaces, checked out a few, you know, things in the area.
The preview book and pages for Soulfire and for Ecos were colored up in my apartment, and he, Jake, and Frank came over and were standing over my shoulder in my bedroom, like looking at my, you know, the pages on my computer screen, because we bought the scanner. That still scanner behind you was like one of the first Aspen purchases, because I'm like, I got nothing to scan your pages in, so we need to buy this.
Found a really cool office space that we liked that was really creative. It was in this down in Marina Del Rey. The building was pretty much full of architects and designers and things like that, so it was just really creative area, high ceilings, big windows, nice and bright, really cool, small but really cool.
You know, we always argued about that stuff. Frank has once famously said, he's like, I never had an argument with Mike. I'm like, I argue with him all the time.
And so we moved in there, and it was just myself, Michael, Peter, Liz Brizzy, who was there helping us, and Talon Caldwell. So it was just us in this little office at the very beginning.
I got a hold of Peter. He's like, yeah, you know, we're starting our own thing. And I was like, yeah, I saw, like, Mike had advertised two possible projects in Wizard magazine. I'm like, it looks awesome. You guys are doing something really cool.
Every single thing was so fresh and new, and I think it really hit a chord with fans and retailers too.
I was like, can you use me? I'm almost done with school. Like, I really wanted to be a part of it. It just seemed really fresh and exciting. And I knew Michael had, like, crazy ideas, and I knew what Peter was capable of, and Frank, I was already good friends with him. And they said, you know, come on out.
So yeah, I mean, the very beginning, it was just us. Marc came in very soon after that, but yeah, it was a really fun time.
He and I started talking about doing a project together. He had just done a series of covers that had happened at DC. He'd never really done superhero work.
We became good friends with the guys at DC because we were already friends with Jeph Loeb and Jeff Johns. Mike was good friends with them.
In 2003, that's when we met up with Dan DeDio, and he jumped. We changed a lot of stuff at DC.
And they said, hey, instead of just sitting around, why don't you come do something for us? And me, Peter, and Michael had dinner one night, and we were talking about it, and like, yeah, let's do it.
Around that time, I was starting to work on a book called Superman Batman, which obviously starred Superman and Batman at DC Comics.
Jeph immediately saw the potential for this. He's like, okay, hey, Mike's here. He's going to draw the really awesome Supergirl.
Mike and I started talking about bringing Supergirl back.
I worked on Superman, Batman, and stuff. I remember when he worked on the Flash covers. Like, it was just crazy. He was like, I don't know much about Flash. He runs really fast. And I was like, no, man, he's cool.
The best part was that he didn't know anything about regular mainstream comics. And so when I would say to him, you know, something as simple as there is no Supergirl, he would say, I don't know what you're talking about. I mean, I know there is a Supergirl.
One of the big things they wanted him to do was, of course, bring back Supergirl, who had supposedly been killed off, you know, a few years back. And he did that very, very successfully. And
I find this so funny because I get mad because Jeph would write something and I'm like, there's no way Superman would do this. And Mike would be looking at me like, so?
And he had gone and read, you know, in 2,000 comics or something so that he could now find out what it was that he was talking about.
You know, we sold almost 2 million copies of 6 different comic books.
I mean, I still have the Supergirl t-shirt, I think.
They were very happy with us and definitely got us for a very good bargain.
And then after the DC work, they were finally in a position, we were finally in a position to be able to kind of just do only Aspen stuff for a little bit.
Then Soulfire came in and...
In 2004, Soulfire number one, and it was one of the top selling independent books of the year.
My job was really to help Mike tell that story. It was not my story with Mike, and it certainly wasn't... It was certainly more Mike's story with me, and...
Jeph helped from the get-go with Soulfire, helped Mike really flesh it out, did the scripts. Jeph, you know, one of the greatest dudes around, and he really, really was there.
And I started working with Peter to work on that with Mike and show it to him. And I was very nervous in the beginning because I was like, here's his new project, Soulfire.
I just remember the night that we were putting it all together, and the main character was this woman who was incredibly strong, and he said, look, I don't have a name for her.
And everything looked so beautiful, and then I'm working on the computer, and I'm scared to delete lines and things. But he was like, no, it's cool. Like,
and I said to him, like, I said, look, you know, if this is a strong maternal figure, even though she's not anybody's mom. And I said, why don't we call it Grace? And he really liked that idea.
He wanted to do something special for his mom, and so he named the heroine Grace.
It sold really well. Like I said, easily one of the top independent books of the year. I think we sold 80, 90,000 copies. It was really cool. Mike was really happy. And
so we did those books. We did Fathom Down a War. We did a couple more minis, and we actually started to kind of gear up to do the second volume of Fathom, to follow in Mike's footsteps. And in between that, we also did Marvel work, Marvel Comics.
And then when Marvel stuff came around, like, everyone was super excited.
That's the time frame when he really just elevated to... He went from already being a superstar to just a whole nother level of artist, because he was doing Marvel Civil War.
He knew Marvel characters, but he... Again, one of the cool things about Mike is that he was sort of not connected to comics very well. Like, he didn't read books all the time, so he would always bring his fresh ideas to him. And a lot of them were more realistic, like more grounded in reality.
Ultimate Wolverine was, I believe, one of the projects that was talked about for Mike to do. He never ended up being able to start that run. I think it was Jeph Loeb.
So he had all these like ideas for Wolverine, and his sketchbook would be filled with just like layouts and sketches and shots that I don't think anyone else has drawn.
No, he wasn't able to. He was only able to do the cover run and then a couple of promo pieces for that, for Wolverine and stuff like that. But
it was really, it sucks that, you know, there's like cover pieces and things that he was like wanting to do and just said like I want to have Wolverine stand on his claws and stuff like that.
No, he never was able to dive into that series, which is, you know, probably one of the big things that, you know, bums me out too. But it's fascinating. You know, there was just years and years of awesome art that, you know, people will never be able to see.
And then he never really got to do it, but he would always like talk about these things of like how he was going to change every project that he worked on, regardless of it was his or someone else's. He always wanted it to be the best.
Mike did everything in his power to try to get rid of this stuff, and for so long he did. It just never left completely.
Nothing got him down, and anything that slowed him down, what would stop most of it was a speed bump.
If there's a more courageous person out there than what Mike was, I'd like to meet him, because just the things that he had to overcome, and he never stopped smiling.
Weeks before he died, I was sitting with him in his playroom, and he looked over at me and he said, "Mom," he said, "you know, they tell me I don't have much of a chance, but," he said, "10 years from now, I'm going to be looking at him saying, huh, I told you I could do this." So he always had the attitude he could beat it up until the very end. And there were so many people lining the halls and in his room the last 2 days of his life, you would have thought there was a rock star at the hospital. He was so loved by so many, and that was something he had wanted his whole life, which is to have friends. And he ended up with more friends than any of us can ever expect to have.
Mike was a champion.
He believed in the people he worked with.
Somebody that was like a best friend to us. And
his spirit never flagged.
He had a different way to do stuff.
Of all the conflict people I ever met, Mike was the best, by far.